John chapter 15, verses 7 to 11. Shall we begin? If you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. By this my Father is glorified that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love. If you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in his love. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that you last week, we began our study on chapter 15 of John, the Gospel of John. And as we looked at the first six verses, we find an analogy of the vine and the branches. Ano po? Jesus being the vine, the true vine, and we, believers and followers of Christ, are the branches, and we are thought of the nature of the church and the function of the church as compared to the branch in the vine. And in this study, we emphasize the importance of bearing fruit. Bearing fruit in our Christian life, because that is the purpose for which God has saved us. Of course, we can philosophize that maraming purposes kung bakit tayo sinave ng Panginoon. Ano po? Pero if you look at the bottom line, the real reason, the true reason for God saving us is that we may bear fruit. And out of that bearing fruit comes out all the other blessings, all the other purposes for which God has saved us. Just as the Almighty Father, the vine dresser, the owner of the vineyard, the one who takes care of the vineyard, just as he intended to plant a vineyard in order for it to produce fruit. Ano po? Which in the beginning, he has given this task to Israel. And Israel disobeyed and failed to produce fruit. Now, Jesus Christ, who is the true vine through which we, who are the churches in the New Testament, are now the branches that we are connected with, that we should produce fruits and more fruit and much fruit. Ano po? Yan po yung message natin last Sunday. And we said that because being fruitful is God's purpose for saving us, we have to understand what being fruitful means. What's the meaning of fruitfulness? Ano po? And we said that being fruitful is the same as growing in Christ-likeness. No? In our context for this chapter, Christ-likeness is being identified as being fruitful. Christ-like in our character, ano po? Yung ating obedience sa mga commands ng Panginoon, yung ating pagiging diligent in repenting of our sins as we commit them and being truthful in what we do, that's our Christ-like character. Being fruitful also means Christ-like in our conduct, in our behavior. If being fruitful in our character means that we are Christ-like inside, okay, when there is no one looking, we are also fruitful in being Christ-like in our conduct, in our day-to-day walk, a walk that is pleasing to the Father as in Philippians. Ano po? Yan po ang pagiging Christ-like conduct. And of course, being fruitful also means we are producing converts, that we strive to lead people to come to Christ through our witness. John chapter 4, verse 36. Seeing them grow in Christ through our influence. Romans chapter 1. So Christ-like in behavior, character, Christ-like in conduct, Christ-like in converts. So bearing fruit means growing in Christ-likeness, in obedience to God, our conduct pleasing to the Lord, and our commitment to lead people to the saving knowledge of our Lord Jesus Christ. And we said that being fruitful takes time to grow. It takes time. It doesn't happen overnight. And it doesn't happen automatically. It takes time and it takes a deliberate effort. And we can call that sometimes as the process of sanctification. Ano ba? And some may bear fruit faster than others. Some of their fruit may be different from others. But every fruit is important. We have to remember that. No matter how you bear fruit, no matter how fast or slow you are, you must bear fruit. If he is not bearing fruit, we must seriously examine our relationship with the vine, Jesus Christ, and seriously ask ourselves, why am I not bearing fruit? No? Why am I not showing a Christian conduct? Why am I not showing a Christian character? Why am I not striving to lead others to Christ? If bearing fruit or being more Christ-like is the purpose for which God planted the vineyard, then we can say that abiding in Jesus Christ or growing in close relationship with the Lord on a day-to-day basis is the only way for us to bear fruit. The only way. Ano po? Hindi kayo magbubunga ng isang bunga na makalulugod sa Panginoon kung hindi tayo nakakabit sa ating Panginoon. Kagaya po lang lagi nating ipinapanalangin. No? John 15:5, for apart from me, you cannot do anything. So if we recognize and accept that being in Jesus Christ, abiding in Jesus Christ, or growing in close relationship with Him is the only way, is the way that we can grow in our Christ-likeness, then we have to understand that being connected to the vine is the only way. If you are not connected to the vine, talagang hindi po tayo magbubunga. Ano po? And that's the topic that our Lord covers in our text today, verses 7 to 11. After He gave the analogy of the vine and the branches, He talks about abiding in Him. Abiding in Him. And the idea is to grow closer to Christ as we live in daily fellowship with Him. Sa totoo lang, mga kapatid, if you are a true believer in Christ, it should be your longing. It should be my longing. It should be the longing of every true believer to know Christ, Jesus, more intimately. Ano po? Ang Apostol Pablo po natin, si Apostol Pablo ito ha, in Philippians 3, he said that he counted everything else as rubbish so that he could know Christ. And to think that when he wrote this epistle, it was 25 years after he has been a believer. 25 years na believer na siya when he wrote the epistle to the Philippians. But he, in fact, admitted that he had not yet obtained that goal after 25 years. And he pressed on toward the mark. Yeah? If the great Apostle Paul still needed to grow in abiding in Jesus Christ after 25 years of being a believer, then certainly we all need to work on growing closer to Jesus. Hindi po ba? Meron pa bang tataas ang commitment sa Panginoon other than the Apostle Paul? But after 25 years, he still says, I have not even obtained the mark. I'm still pressing on toward the goal. So our text reveals five aspects of abiding in Jesus Christ. This time, we will be literally expositing all the five verses one after the other. Ano po? Kaya hindi ko po inilagay yung scripture text sa kaliwa ng inyong bulletin. It's on the right because we are going to study it on a verse-by-verse basis. The first aspect is that we abide in His Word and in prayer. In verse 7, ang sabi po ng Panginoon, if you abide in me and my words abide in you, ask whatever you wish and it will be done to you. I'm sure you still remember that back in chapter 14, there is a similar promise. Similar yung promise ng Lord. Ang sabi niya dun sa verse 14, verse 13, chapter 14, verse 13, whatever you ask in my name, this I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And to ask in Jesus' name means that we ask on the basis of who He is and what He has done for us on the cross. Yun po ang ibig sabihin ng asking in the name of Jesus. It assumes that we are seeking to do His will and promoting His kingdom purpose. So in verses 7 all the way to 11 from chapter 15, instead of emphasizing asking in Jesus' name, He moved to that condition that we must abide in Him and His words. Well, it is almost similar. If you look at the definition of the context, it is almost similar, but it has a different tone. In chapter 14, asking in His name. In chapter 15, there are two things. First, His words must abide in us. Pag sinabi pong His words, ang ibig sabihin yon, everything that Jesus taught us. In the Old Testament, everything that was written there all point to Jesus, hindi po ba? And in the New Testament, everything is about Jesus Christ, His life, His work, and the furtherance of His teaching by the apostles. Although it is true, and I understand, and I accept, that sometimes God reveals Himself through other areas, no? Through prayer, through meditation, through vision, through dreams. No? Sabi ng ibang mga kabataan, Pastor, hindi na po ngayon masyadong kailangan magbasa ng Biblia kasi ang mga kabataan po, they dream dreams and they see vision. That's okay, that's true. But remember, the primary basis of God revealing Himself to us is through His written word. Huwag po natin kakalimutan yan. Okay? In fact, if you have dreams, if you have visions, you have to check it against the Bible. If your dream or your vision doesn't align with the Bible, then that's not to be accepted. Okay? The Bible should be the basis of which God reveals Himself. It should always be our default mode. Okay? Kumbaga sa computer, default mode natin ang Biblia. Okay? So if you want to continually abide in Jesus Christ, spend much time in His Word. Always asking the Holy Spirit to reveal more of Christ to you. So to grow closer to Jesus Christ, read your Bible over and over until you are at home with it. No? Feel at home ka in reading the Bible. Another aspect of verse 7 as compared to verse 13 of chapter 14 is we ask and receive from Him in prayer. Jesus says that if we abide in Him and His words abide in us, then ask whatever you wish and it will be done for you. Okay? The context here is bearing fruit. bearing fruit for His kingdom. Ang point po ng Panginoon sa verse 7 is that if we live in close relationship with Him and His Word governs our request, we should be asking and receiving more from Him on a regular basis. Okay? Ang sabi po ni John Calvin, I would like to, meron siyang isang magandang patotoo tungkol dito sa katotohanan ito sa kanyang libro, yung Institutes of the Christian Religion. Kaya lang, it's so old English. Kaya ipaparaphrase ko na lang po. Ang sabi po ni John Calvin dyan, when we recognize that God is sovereign, yun ang una nating premise, we recognize that God is sovereign, that whatever we need and whatever we lack is in God through our faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. If we understand that, through whom the Father has given everything for our good, then, ang sabi niya, we can draw from this everlasting truth that in our everyday needs, we should always seek Him in confidence and pray to Him boldly what we need for in life of godliness in Him. Okay? I hope that is clear to you. Kasi ang premise, naniniwala tayong sovereign si Lord. And because He is sovereign, He has given everything to the Lord Jesus Christ for our good. And because He is sovereign and the Lord Jesus Christ treat us as sons of God, then ergo, parang ibig sabihin ganon, ang ibig sabihin nun, we can ask boldly and we can ask as frequently as we want. Because it is His desire to grant our wish. In other words, be it in good times or in bad times, we know God will answer our prayers in a way that is good for us, regardless of whether it is answered in a way that we wanted it. Ano po? But it should always be for our good. Sometimes He does not give us exactly what we want, but it will always be aligned with His good and perfect will for our good. Romans 8:28. Okay po ba? Yun ang ibig sabihin ng we ask and receive from Him in prayers. And the condition is, if we abide in Him and His words abide in us. So abiding in Jesus is knowing His word and asking Him in prayer. Second aspect, the Almighty Father is glorified in our fruitfulness. Verse 8, by this my Father is glorified that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples. As I have pointed out earlier, it is clear from our text that the purpose for which God saved us is that we should bear fruit, much fruit. And the point of planting vineyard is not to grow leaves or flowers or big trunks, but to grow fruit. Yan po ang ibig sabihin ng vineyard. While God has given each one of us different gifts, we should use those gifts to bear fruit for His kingdom. Okay? Let me give you a very vivid illustration, which I'm sure you can all relate to. Okay? I have always been raised in the province. Nang magpunta na po ako ng Maynila, ay college na. So all the years I've spent in the province, in Laguna. But I still have difficulty in identifying some types of trees. Of course, dahil tigapaete po ako, Lansones, kitang-kita ko na yan. Kahit saan ako lumingon, may Lansones tree. No? O kaya, meron pong, anong tawag dyan? Guava. No? Bayabas. Yung dalawang yan, sandali ko lang ma-identify yan. Pero yung santol, yung siniguelas, yung atis, yung mga yan, hindi ko po yan talagang alam kung sa tingin ko sa puno, santol yan. O siniguelas yan. O atis yan, hindi ko kaya until it is their season. Of course, pag nakita ko yung punong-punong-puno ng yellowish round fruit na cluster, santol yan. Di ba? Pag nakita ko yung puno na medyo pear-shaped na nakahang dun sa branches niya, na sunod-sunod, nagkukulay yellow, sometimes greenish pa siya, ay mangga yan. Alright? You see my point? While the Lord has already said that, no? Sabi niya sa Matthew 7:20, you will know the tree by its fruit. And so it's easy. If the tree is not bearing fruit, you will never know. Sometimes you cannot even identify. But if you apply that to the context that we have this morning, it is very convicting. If you look at it carefully, it is such a convicting analogy that when people do not know that you are a Christian, then check your fruit. If you indeed should be bearing fruit, they will easily know that you are a Christian. You will know its fruit by its, you will know the tree by its fruit. Right? I trust that you know this. The chief end of man is to glorify God and enjoy Him forever. Hindi po ba? Westminster Catechism. Jesus says that when we glorify God, when we bear fruit, that is what is pleasing to God. So you see what I mean by saying that at the bottom of everything, bearing fruit is the purpose for which God saved us. But our chief end is to glorify Him and to enjoy Him forever. But if we are bearing fruit, that in itself is a glorifying gift to God. As others see what God produces in and through us, as we live closely with the Lord Jesus, they will get a glimpse of what He is like. No? Imagine po ninyo, if you are, your conduct exudes the fruit of the Spirit. Okay? Love, peace, joy, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. If you are showing those things, then people will say, this guy is a Christian. And God is glorified. God is glorified. And so it's very important, mga kapatid, that you don't only have a Christian behavior. That means your character should be inside. That's the most important thing. Who you are inside. If you are obeying the commandments, kahit nag-i-slip up ka, medyo malalaman nila, makikita pa rin nila. But it is important that you bear fruit in your conduct. And as a personal reality check, you have to keep two things in mind on regards to this. First, check your motives. Check your motives. Why do you want to bear fruit? You try to question yourself that. It is easy to fall into the trap of serving the Lord so that others will say nice things about you. Ano po? Yeah? Pwede pong mangyari yan. You are serving the Lord. But here it is, brothers and sisters. If you feel hurt when people do not give you enough praise, then probably that's an indication that you are not serving for God's glory, but for your own. Okay? Second, check your source of power. If you're serving the Lord in your own strength and just asking God to help you from time to time, then you're not serving in His power. serving in the power of God doesn't mean you don't work hard. No, that doesn't mean that. You still work hard, but in working hard, you rely on God's power. Because it is not you. Okay? Paul says it very clearly. Colossians 1:29, "For this I toil, struggling with all His energy that He powerfully works within me." Okay? You work hard, but all the energy and the power that is inside the work is from God. Yeah? If you feel burnout for serving God, then check your source of power. Okay? You might be serving in your power, not in God's power. Because the truth is, serving God is not work. Serving God is a privilege. Okay? And you should have all the joy and the stamina and the strength in serving Him. Because it's not you. You are just being used as a vessel for it. So check your motives and check your source of power. Pero ang maganda po dito sa verse na ito, mga kapatid, is that there is a very visible benefit of glorifying God by bearing fruit. Ang sabi po dun sa last phrase ng verse 8, "So prove to be my disciples." By growing fruit and glorifying God in the process, it proves to you that you are truly a disciple. Ang sabi po ni J.C. Ryle, okay? This is what he said. Balik tayo doon. Kapatid. Sabi ni J.C. Ryle, "Fruitfulness in Christian practice will not only bring glory to God, but will supply the best evidence to our own hearts that we are real disciples of Christ." I'm sure nangyari na po sa inyo yan. When you do something for others, and they see the fruit of your labor, and God gets the glory, it has so much joy and difference in your life to think that you work it out, knowing that you did not do anything in your own strength. It happened because God did it for you. And so inside you, alam na alam mo, I am a disciple because God works through me. God empowers me to do this for others. It assures your heart. Ano po? I'm sure you have those things sometimes or many times for others. It assures your heart that you are a true disciple of Jesus Christ. Okay? So abiding in Jesus Christ means that we abide in His Word and in prayer, and we glorify the Father by bearing fruit. The third aspect is we abide in His love. Verse 9, "As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. Abide in my love." Look at these words for a moment, brothers and sisters, and see how staggering the words are. No? Kung ang Ama, the Almighty Father, loved the Lord Jesus Christ with an everlasting love, with a perfect love, always, never wavering sa kanyang pagmamahal sa kanyang anak. And if it is the same love that Jesus Christ gives to us, wow! Imagine po ninyo yung kind of love na yon, no? It should be motivation enough for us to abide in the Lord, no? If you realize that the kind of love that Jesus gives us is the same kind of perfect, unwavering, inexhaustible, infinite kind of love of the Father to the Son. Yan po yung ibig sabihin nun eh. As the Father has loved me, so have I loved you. That is a powerful motivation to me. And I think to all of us for striving to abide in Jesus Christ. Sabi sa Galatians 2, no? I have been crucified with Christ, sabi ni Paul. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life that I now live, I live in the flesh by the faith in the Son of God who loved me. The Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. How staggering is that kind of love of the Lord Jesus? Abiding in Christ's love is absolutely essential if you want a genuine, fresh, and fruitful Christian life. Okay? Yan po yung totoo niyan. If your love for the Lord, you feel that it is fading, okay? If that kind of love for the Lord, which He has lavishly poured on us in perfect ways, unwavering, somehow it seems like to you, it's fading. You know what happens? Obeying His commands will become burdensome for you. Okay? Believe me, I have that experience myself. If your love for Jesus is fading, you feel like it's fading, you're not exercising it, you're okay na matulog sa gabi nang hindi mo kausap ang Panginoon bago ka matulog. Okay? Pag nag-serve ka the following day, it seems like a drudgery to you. And you're vulnerable, nagiging vulnerable ka to all kinds of temptation. That's true. I'm sure that's true to you, that's true to me. That's why the Lord Jesus Christ confronted the church in Ephesus. Ang sabi niya, mabait kayo, nagsisilbi kayo. You weather the persecution that these people, these unbelievers are attacking you. But you hold the right doctrines. Sabi dun sa Church of Ephesus in Revelation chapter 2. Pero ang sabi ng Panginoon, but I have this against you. You have lost or you have left your first love. Okay? Maaaring sabihin natin, ang ibig sabihin talaga doon, ang context ng pagkasabi, yung pag-ibig natin sa Panginoon ay nawala. No? Parang ganon. Pero in the context of our text this morning, ang totoo nan, you have not kept the love of Christ in you. You do not leave your first love. Your first love, if you are a true believer, that love is there. It will never go away. Pero ang nawawala, yung understanding, yung appreciation of the love of Christ in us. Parang yun po yung ibig sabihin ni Apostle Pablo sa Church of Ephesus in our context this morning. Ano po? And my advice to you and to me is that we should never get over the wonder that the eternal Son of God loved us and gave Himself for us. As He has prayed for the Ephesians in Ephesians chapter 7, verse 17 to 19, small letters lang po, but I will recite it, that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith, that you, being rooted and grounded in love, may have strength to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. When the apostle When the Lord Jesus Christ castigated the church in Ephesus, in Revelation chapter 2, in our context, we should understand it that what is being neglected here is the love of Christ in us. If we have not appreciated the love of Christ in us, then yun nga, nagiging burdensome lahat ng paglilingkod natin sa Kanya. We need to think this through a bit more carefully, brothers and sisters, because often Christians doubt Christ's love when we go through difficult times. Sa totoo lang naman po, no? They mistakenly think, if God really loved me, He would not allow these awful things to happen to me. But say again, look at the relationship of God the Father and the Son. Ang sabi po doon, as the Father have loved me, so I have loved you. The Almighty Father's love for Jesus Christ is perfect, infinite, unwavering, inexhaustible, unlimited. If that is the kind of love the Father has given to the Son, ang sasabihin natin, if we are facing trial, the Father's perfect love for the Son means that He spared His Son from trials. Diba? Kung ganon ang definition ng love ng Father sa kanyang anak, then we will think, if we are suffering, then the Father's perfect love for the Son means that He spared His Son from trials because He loved the Son perfectly. But no, the Son came to do the Father's will, and that is going to the cross. So does the Lord's perfect love for you means that He will spare you from all the trials? No. Because it is usually through the trials that we come to know Him more deeply. Amen? If we are experiencing trials and we succumb to trials and we overcome the trials after that, no? We know Him more deeply. It is what Paul called the fellowship of His sufferings. Tayo lang ang makakaintindi ng word na yan. No? How can we have fellowship in suffering? Diba? But that's what the Apostle Paul said in Philippians 3:10. It is the fellowship in sufferings. It is through the trials and tribulations in our lives that we know God more deeply. So someone said, I don't know who said this, but he said, never interpret God's love by your circumstances. Rather, interpret your circumstances by God's love. Always look at the love of God in whatever happens to you, good or bad. Kasi you know that God is sovereign. Ano po? Fourth aspect, abide in Jesus Christ in our obedience. John chapter 15 verse 10 says, if you keep my commandments, you will abide in my love, just as I have kept my Father's commandments and abide in His love. We abide in Jesus Christ through our obedience. Jesus doesn't let us think that abiding in His love is just a warm, fuzzy feelings. He plainly states that to abide in His love, we must obey His commandments. Very simple. And the flip side of that is that if you're not abiding in His love, you're not living in obedience to His commandments. Because it's relatively easy to obey the Lord when things are going well. But the real test of obedience is when He takes us through difficult trials. And there are such times when we do not understand, no? Why trials are happening to you. Sometimes you do not understand. Abraham could not even understand why God has asked him to sacrifice his son at Mount Moriah. He could never understand that until he trusted and obeyed God. That is when he understood. There was a story, and I like this story because it very poignantly expressed yung ibig sabihin nito. Okay? Si Elizabeth Elliot, ang unang asawa niya is Jim Elliot. Jim Elliot is a missionary in Auca, India. Indian area in the southern part of America. And during his mission trip there, kapababa pa lang niya doon, I think sandali lang, pinatay na siya ng mga Auca Indians. Itong si Jim Elliot. Okay? Elizabeth later remarried. But again, she lost her second husband, Addison Lights, to cancer. So dalawang magkasunod na napakalagim na pangyayari sa buhay ni Elizabeth Elliot. And she became very popular because of the influence of the Jim. Okay, so she was invited in many conferences. She went to Europe in Wales, no? And nakita niya yung process ng paglilinis sa mga tupa. Palagay ko marami sa atin ang hindi nakakaintindi ng kung paano ginagawa. Kasi ang mga tupa, yung mga rams, sheep and rams, suffer some infections because of the way they are raised. No? They wander, they graze in the field, and many times merong mga infections, mga foreign elements na kumakapit doon sa kanilang mga wool. Okay? So yung pala, ang ginagawa doon sa Wales is merong isang malaking timba na ang laman nun antiseptic. And the shepherd and his dog will usher its ram or its sheep to, para lumubog doon sa antiseptic tank. Okay? So pagkalagay ng sheep doon, siyempre papalag yun, no? Tapos ang gagawin ng aso, ipipilit pa niyang ipasok dun sa, hindi niya palalabasin. And after that, yung shepherd naman, meron daw siyang isang wooden implement that he will take the sheep or the ram by its horn, kung ram or sheep by its neck, at babaligtarin pa niya ng babaligtarin dun sa timba. At ilulubog niya for several seconds just to make sure that every wool is covered with antiseptic. Si Elizabeth Elliot, awang-awa po dun sa mga tupa. And she asked the wife of the shepherd, does the sheep know why this happened to them? Eh sabi ng wife, of course not. They haven't had a clue. And then Elizabeth Elliot remembered. Sabi niya, I have had some experience in my life that have made me feel very sympathetic to those poor sheep. I couldn't figure out any reason for the treatment I was getting from the shepherd I trusted. He didn't give me a hint of explanation. When her husband was killed by a spear by the Auca Indian in a missionary trip, God did not even have given him or her a hint of why it happened. And where her second husband died of cancer, God never did give him a hint of why he did that. But she pointed out, we still must trust our shepherd and obey him, knowing that he has our best interests at heart. It is through obedience in times of suffering that we grow closer to the Savior who suffered and died for us. Elizabeth Elliot is now recognized as a true child of God because of that conviction. So to abide in Jesus Christ, immerse yourself in His Word and in prayer, live to glorify the Father by bearing fruit, abide in Jesus' love and His obedience. Okay? And the last one, abide in His joy. Abide in Jesus Christ in His joy. These things I have spoken to you, that my joy may be in you, and that your joy may be full. ESB version po yan. Kung tatanungin ko kayo, what word pops up in your mind when you hear the word obedience? Ang una bang pumasok sa isip mo, kagaya ko, duty. Obedience is duty. Obedience is obligation. No? It is a rule. It is a command. It's not fun. Okay? What about joy? If you equate obedience with joy or fullness of joy, mga kapatid, no? That's the way Jesus associates obedience with. He associates obedience with our experiencing full joy in Him. Kasi yung verse 11 is connected to verse 10. If you keep my commandments, ang sinabi sa verse 11, you may have joy and that your joy may be full. If you don't associate obedience with joy and fullness of it, maybe you need to change our thinking as I did. No? The world can only offer joy when things are going well. We know that, no? Lagi. It's relatively easy to be full of joy when you are happy, when you have a good marriage, when your children are all obedient, you have a good job, and you have good health. It's easy to have joy. But it's only those who know Christ who can say this. Romans 5:3. More than that, we rejoice in our sufferings. Hindi po maiintindihan ng mga unbelievers yan, mga kapatid. Tayo lang pong mga believers ang makakaintindi niyan. More than that, we rejoice in our sufferings. Or James chapter 1 verse 2, count it all joy, my brothers, when you meet trials of various kinds. Count it all joy when you meet trials of various kinds. Or 1 Peter 4:13, but rejoice in so far as you share Christ's suffering, that you may also rejoice and be glad when His glory is revealed. Okay? When we obey Christ, we should have joy. But it's not easy. Okay? It is not easy. It doesn't mean putting on a happy face when we are suffering. No? Hypocrisy po yun. Yeah? When you're hurting inside, definitely, you will not put a happy face. No? Hebrews 12 realistically says that God's discipline for the moment does not seem joyful, but sorrowful. The Bible acknowledges that there is always a time for tears and grieving. Romans 12:15 says, rejoice with those who rejoice. Weep with those who weep. In fact, the Lord Jesus Christ did that. When He went to the tomb of Lazarus, what did He do? Did He smile? No, He wept. The Lord Jesus wept. But the meaning of this text is that in all of these challenges, when we go through all these challenges, Jesus promised that by consistently abiding in Him and His Word and in prayer, in love and obedience, His joy will be in us. It may not be surfacing externally, but it will be in us and our joy may be full. Four things that will lead to joy. Ano po? Abiding in His Word, mga kapatid, tandaan natin yung limang yan. Abiding in His Word and in prayer. Abiding in truthfulness. Abiding in His love. And abiding in His obedience. If you do all of those four things, you will have joy. And your joy will be full. What an awesome promise. I-connect ninyo yan doon sa first six verses of chapter 15. And continue reading from verse 1 to verse 11. You will have joy in your heart. Ano po? Let us pray. Salamat po, Panginoon, sa katotohanan ng iyong salita. As we focus on being connected to you, and as we remember that you yourself said that apart from you, we cannot do anything. But ang kalbaligtaran po nun, the flip side of that is that if we abide in you and your word abide in us, we can ask whatever we want or we wish. And it will be done for us. It may not be the same exact way of answer that you will give us, but it will definitely be for our good. Because you loved us and you called us according to your purpose. We thank you, Lord. Allow these words to be kept in our hearts and in our minds even through the week, Panginoon, sapagkat kailangan po namin ng encouragement sa lahat ng oras. Even as we face tomorrow's decision to vote for people who will govern our Senate and our Congress and our town, Lord, would you use these words? Would you use this teaching in the first 11 verses of chapter 15 para makita po namin that anything that happens is under your control. You are sovereign and you will do whatever it takes to make us holy. Salamat po sa iyong kabutihan. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.